The reason why he's here today is because also the guy who is behind our Inner Source initiative, because he was the one who actually kicked it off in 2008, and I'm so grateful for that, actually, because I had a great time doing Inner Source. So, Stefan.
Yeah. You want to take this mic? I'm going to take the other mic, rather. I can switch over, but maybe I start already. The first part I can do without that. When I arrived 2004 in a new job here in very close to Renning in Schwieberding, I was asked to run a research department on, remember these words, CMMI, SPICE, software product lines and software architectures. I ended up on the 2nd of January in Schwieberding. I tried to enter the office, but it turned out that in Swabian you don't work between 1st of Jan and Dreikönigs Tage, so you have to rather start on the 7th of January. So I was left alone here in that area, and I was thinking, so is this really worth doing just CMMI and automotive SPICE and all this stuff in the research department? So what is really a game changer I can work on? And because I was alone and I surfed around a little bit in the internet, I really thought that the only thing that really interesting to tap in from a strategic point of view is this open source thing. But at that time, I didn't know, or I had the feeling we are too late already. I thought open source with all the stuff that was going on around GNU, like you know, the GNU compiler at that time, Emacs was my favorite editor. I always felt it's probably too late for Bosch to join. But somehow I felt, now maybe we give it a try. And since then, I was tapping into this open source stuff. And basically, and this was my picture at that time. It was old industry, so Bosch, and teaching an old company at that time, 120 years old, now 130 years old, some new tricks. And this picture has been with me quite some time. Also, my friend Hans-Jürgen Kugler took this over. He sometimes gives presentations with this title. And yeah, this is the, I think, a good way of explaining what you have to do. You need also some puppy dogs around, some new guys. And my new guy who was on the board was Hans-Malte Kern. He was the first person I hired. And it was a difficult process of hiring because we did an interview. I liked him. He was probably the only open source guy in the world who wanted to work for Bosch. I said, okay, there's no other option. I have to hire him. And then HR department basically said, he doesn't fit to our culture. We don't hire him. And he said, analysis right, conclusion wrong. So he didn't fit to our culture, but that's why we need him. And so I basically pushed to hire him, and since then we got more and more people on board, and we started the wave along that. And from the talk I give today, by the way, there's a Twitter handle if you want to Twitter, please start right away. I'm now on the social media hype, so I'm evaluated every month whether I'm on the top 50. It gives you a lot of pressure. Yeah, you can tweet everything what I can say. So you can tweet everything what I say. The problem is I have some slides which say strictly confidential or streng vertraulich. I show them today. They're from my archives. They're pretty old, but they're still strictly confidential. And I will let you know that you please do not take them with you. And at that time, I was thinking of Emacs was a tool. GNU compiler was a tool. But why are there so much open source products out there? Linux operating system was on the rim, so it was coming a little bit. And at that time, I thought, if you want to change a company, teaching the old dog a new trick, where do you really start? And this was a matrix on my wall, sometime where it has collaboration on the front and the scope of where you do the collaboration on the other axis. And I had the feeling at that time we rather start in the left top corner. So we rather start internal cooperation with internal IT or internal stuff like wikis and all these things. And afterwards, now I understand why we did that, and I think it was a good decision in terms of change management. You start on a path with Inner Source, you think about cost savings in the beginning, and then you can move over to products or external, but these are steps which are much more difficult. They're more complex, they're also more risky. For example, if you put a product in open source space, you need a different business model. You need much more people from sales and business development and management being involved. Whereas if you do internal tooling, you rather engage with the people who use the tool and maybe somebody who's administrating the tool. So much simpler. Also, the all the by-products from lawyers and stuff are much simpler. But you can also go the internal way, and here in the step number two, do tooling with external partners. And this is exactly what we did around Automotive Eclipse. This was the first move out of the Bosch world, where Bosch joined the open source movement, because the pain of doing collaboration in the automotive software development for embedded software is so harsh that we basically agreed with other suppliers and other car manufacturers to do open source style tooling. Yeah, but the for me, the most difficult piece, and you see this in red here, is doing products open source, and this is what I do now in my current job. But I believe for a company like Bosch, it was good to go through this path to do this learning. I don't know whether it's still valid for other companies, but at least that's the path we went through. And this journey is a little bit the part of my presentation. This is an official slide from Bosch Group. You can take a picture, it's public. And it says, it's really accidentally, I saw yesterday, Bosch, a global network. And I thought, yeah, that's that we want to be, that's the wish. But the reality is, these are silos. These are organizations who have learned 130 years to work very independently. They even sometimes incentivize not to work together. Why is that? Because you want to avoid that one of your customers is telling you, I get your cool navigation systems only if you lower the price for the diesel injection. This is kind of business you don't want to be in. And that's why you separate this kind of business. The separation means they are run like companies by themselves, like different entities, different budget, different heads. And it has been success pattern within Bosch to do that, because some of this business doing better sometime, if you go through a crisis, they don't hit you all the time. For example, industrial technology is always something that is hitting by crisis very early. If demand gets lower, companies buy less machines, then they invest less in the production capabilities. And whereas in the consumer side, this comes up a little bit later. So there was one crisis, the big crisis we went through from the Lehman Brothers, where it was not true. So it was all hit the same time. But over the years, we saw this as a success factor. But in a networked world, where products, companies, processes get together, we also need a mechanism to collaborate. And this was also my motivation in 2004 to jump into this. Yeah, and this is our history. This is a picture taken not far away from here in Stuttgart, production of spark plugs. And if you just look a little bit what kind of people you see here. So you see the ladies doing the work. Do you feel they are encouraged to interact with their colleagues? There's some men behind watching them. That's bad. There's another guy. Actually, the department head, he is on the right-hand side. That's cut off here in this picture. And he's overseeing the overall arena. And if you just look at that, there's some professors who analyze this. This is a very typical setup in a company which is run by people who are coming more from the Puritanian non-Catholic side of believing world, because efficiency is the main goal, getting to the value of the company. And actually the department head is sitting over there. He's overwatching all of this. So the overall idea of the system, and it was true at the time, is that efficiency control, fast and central, bigger and better, and hierarchy and fast was true. What was the reason why it's true? Because communication was so expensive. Sending a letter from a plant in Japan to Germany took a lot of time. So you really had to think through this funnel, what you send through. How do you get this efficiency man? You don't have a lot of people who could read and write at that time very well. So you had to adapt a system that was bulletproof, foolproof overall. So a success factor. But if you look at the way we work at Bosch Software Innovations today, very different. So we're an agile company, iterative, distributed, network, and open, and of course extremely flat. And this is basically something that some of the spearhead organization working style right now, But this was also a pattern I saw within the open source community, that people from around the world, no matter where they come from, which culture, they collaborate. And even people like Richard Stallman are able to drive cultures and communities, which is very strange, isn't it? And I thought, this, we can learn from something from him. Yeah, so this was the starting point. This is a slide I did in 2006. So I admit already that this is probably my presentation with the ugliest slides I ever had, but I want to keep it authentic. So this is the way we presented at that time. So we tried to convince the world that, hey, this open source stuff is cool at that time. A little bit difficult if you just have the logos there. And in 2004, it was also that most people in the Bosch group believed that open source is something like hackers and yeah, it's more like Karl Marx, your hand in somebody else's pocket, you don't make money with that. I always felt like I'm crucified if I talked about open source at that time. So it was really also from the culture point of view not okay to talk about it. What do you do with patterns? How do you keep things proprietary? Where's your core competence? You send everybody to external parties, and it was very difficult to change a culture thinking about that one. And my presentation today is mostly about how I found patterns to attract different stakeholders in the company to look at that. A lawyer has different questions than from a top manager. And how to convince people doing things differently. This is basically the Montauk. And this is why this teaching is so important, that one. This was a time when everybody was basically agreeing that Microsoft is ugly. And all the open source community was fighting Steve Jobs and Ballmer later. And my learning from that is having a common enemy helps. It's a classic empirical mechanism. Though you don't agree along all the open source and company movement around that one, they all agree that there's one ugly guy and company in the room. If you look at how Microsoft is dealing today with open source, very different company. Actually, at that time, Microsoft was pushing a lot of stuff in open source, like XML, for example, from their side. We haven't recognized really as a community too. But what we used to convince people to look at the topic was this slide, and this worked pretty well. And it was the Steve Ballmer quote that this is a cancer, Linux is a cancer. And Mariette was basically pointing out it's violating everything we learn from management. And then if you have managers who are keen to work on innovation, they look at this, okay, if such a strong word is in a room, then it's at least a disruptive force. And with this one, you are allowed to work on a corporate department, because if you work on disruption, you're well aligned and everybody shows you, hey, we do open source, that's cool, it's disruptive, we do things nobody else allows themselves to do. Yeah, but by the way, do you feel this little, there's some imbalance in this room? Do you know Feng Shui? Yeah, Feng Shui, all the people sitting in the back, nobody wants to come to the front. Do you think we get some more balance in here? You think so? Would you help to bring some balance in? Yeah, no, you don't want to. Yeah, okay. It's okay. Would you give me a favor? Just raise your arm on your side, your right arm on that side, yeah? Is somebody on the other side also raising your arm to get some balance in the room? Okay, thank you. So let's see whether this gets better now. Just a few seconds, not very long. So this was a slide I did, I think it was 2008, it's a version from 2009, how we wanted to go through. It's in English, it's good. And it's only confidential, though it's not strictly confidential. We did some studies in corporate research. We had together with some business units working around Eclipse. Eclipse is a tool for automotive, this worked pretty well. And we had the step number three, our Bosch internal open source experiment. And we opted to jump into the Willow Garage. This is an open source for robotics, also the tooling side. And then we had the idea to build an automotive Eclipse tooling ecosystem. And then our plan was for 2014, open source is well understood business option for Bosch. Hey, my dear, I didn't know what I wrote down there. And it basically boiled down to the very simple question. Mike Milenkovic from Eclipse Foundation always challenged me that if Bosch would join Eclipse or would even be a strategic member in Eclipse, then you do real business in that. And we had always a bet on that, whether Bosch would join or not. And Ralf Müller, he's with Eclipse Foundation, he said, I never believe it will happen. But I proved him wrong, so I was able to tell him later how to do that. And for this topic number three, how to do Bosch internal open source experiment, this is the original chart from my board. You don't have to read anything on that. It's not confidential, by the way. It's the way Hans Maltekern and I came up with the idea how to set up a protective system within the company to make it happen. You might see this on the right side. There is some blurring cloud around an organization. So the key understanding in that session, it was about 2 hours session, was that we have to protect the people who do this open source stuff from the rest of the organization. So the most important piece is having a layer around that they can work independently. And now I can show you how this evolved, this idea. So from, I think this was 2007. There was also this name of Blauer Engel, and yeah, also what also important is you do the measurement, it's also down there, the measurement in the system, and you don't let anybody else outside know about that one to really protect it. So this was coming out, this is in German now. This was the first announcement of Bosch that we do Bosch internal open source 5 years later. 2011, and it was a German slide. And then you see this biosphere where we admitted that we have to protect the people who work in inner source in a sort of a biosphere. It's a better name for this one. And the concept is, I think, best written and depicted now in Georg's nice slide from 2018 explaining how we do internal open source in our bios and biosphere nowadays. But you see, the core idea was pretty old, and bringing this into practice also required some change in central directives, how people work in there, 10% of their time, how they are protected from their boss, and all these things. But the key learning was inner source also requires some heavy island, some area where you can work independently from the rest of the organization in big companies. In smaller companies, it might be different. Yeah. Starting with tooling, not with products. Yeah, tools is the point. Hey, you! I ask you to raise the hands in order to keep the balance. Because you know why? I'm looking for some volunteers, and I'm happy that you are the first one. So what I have here is a small package. It's for later. So you keep it now, and you touch and feel it, and you think about what it could be, but don't open it.
Okay.
Get some more volunteers on the other side. What is this for? You a volunteer? So you get the box one. The other one. So, but please don't open it. You can touch it, you can think about what it is, but don't look into that. So we started, as I mentioned, also with the tooling side and not with products. This is an announcement of Eclipse IDE for automotive software developers. So this was a result that came out of that years later. The pain of the automotive industry being ripped off by tooling companies over years. I don't name the names now, but a lot of companies made a lot of money to get a lot of tools specialized for automotive, for BMW, Daimler, Porsche, Conti, Bosch, and so on. And the pain was so strong that these companies agreed, hey, we do an Eclipse-based approach because Eclipse is free. We can rather easier exchange models across the automotive domain. This also happened at the same time where AUTOSAR was started, and there was also a need for tooling for AUTOSAR. So this was a clear path and a successful path because there was a clear cost saving, better collaboration for all the companies in the automotive domain, and it did not touch the products. So you were not really thinking about the car itself, but the tooling for the car. And this is always an area where all the lawyers and business people are much more relaxed, because sometimes you don't even have to talk to them. And this was exactly one of the paths we went through. This is a slide, yeah, from 2018, looking backward. RTOP was an extension for Eclipse, particular targeting at Eclipse technology for AUTOSAR. This was a project run by Conti, actually by a guy who worked for Bosch before in the same department where we started all this open source stuff, went to Conti and moved on with that, very successful. Then we started the Eclipse Automotive Working Group. And another project that came later on that is this Almatea for Public. And there's another pattern that came up into this one, also strong pattern now, is that a lot of European projects now do dissemination of software in open source. And that's why Eclipse Foundation, for example, is involved in so many public funded projects, because in the end, a public funded project in Europe has to disseminate also the software, the source code. And how do you do that? The report you can print and put on the internet, but that software is in the later usable, that you have a clear license around that one is also a successful pattern for open source from the just from the license point of view. Yeah, this was one successful path there. This was a model that was brought up by Eclipse Foundation. I think it was from 2006. But the earliest slide I could find was 2008. So this is the oldest slide I could find there. And this is a maturity model for companies to engage into in our open source. And most companies start in the phase zero, deny. I don't know whether you ever worked in a company where this was a state of affair. Nobody? Okay. You've been not with Bosch, specifically. And then usually engineers start using, contributing, and also championing some projects. You see this, that there's some successful spearhead projects or people who, for tooling or for product size, are along that way. But it's very difficult step to move over to the business side, that inner and open source really becomes an option for running your business differently. The point is, you cannot start on the right side, because if you don't have the engineers prepared, you fail implementing a strategy. That's why this long curve of going through that is just required. We did an adaption of that slide a year later. So this became an official knowledge of the of Bosch. So it was accepted as a state of affair. And actually in 2009, we admitted, we had won, I think. It was true for some areas within Bosch, not for everyone. Just yesterday, we had our steering committee for open source, and the question was, is everybody in the Bosch world capable of contributing software to Eclipse Foundation as of today? And of course, not every unit is as prepared for that one, but a lot are. And we also champion, and we also have 4 and 5 steps now in our company today. But it's a journey. And this is the slide from Ralf Müller we basically used. And making clear that this is a journey is also important to admit, because going through all the difficulties you have to go through, getting lawyers understand what the implication is for your IP, how you do the patent work along with that, how you change your marketing because you're investing in open source and in your product at the same time, how you bring up partner management. The whole company basically also has to change. And this is not something just some engineers can do. But without the engineers, it won't work, so that's also true. Yeah, now I come to a picture. This is a slide I'm showing tomorrow, a little up to the future. I'm engaging tomorrow in an advisory board meeting with Huawei. And now we are trying to convince Huawei to join our platform initiative in Internet of Things. This is a slide. I encourage them to join the Eclipse IoT Working Group and become a strategic member. So it's very funny. So I, as a Bosch guy, go to another company. I rather take on my business card as an Eclipse board member and do leads and sales for a foundation. in the interest of the Bosch company. And this is a very different sales approach, and I go there and sell my own software. Of course, I have a business model with my own software along, and if Huawei pays for that, that's also fine. But the key ingredient is that I want to join them. Two reasons. First of all, we want to capture the Asian market, and Huawei is a great company in Asia. If you're along with them, you tap a lot more customer. And on the other hand, they have a lot of cool engineers who know how to do narrowband communication. So if you want to do LoRa, Sigfox, and all this stuff, they have a lot of experience, they know the hardware, and they know exactly how to set up the protocols. So having them in my ecosystem makes my product and my open source community much better, more valuable. And this is exactly the step number 4 and 5, because it's an iteration. We know that we're missing a company of this breed in our ecosystem, and we try to get into that. And yeah, this is then basically the most difficult part, getting open source work in the strategic way. Yeah, by the way, it's working pretty well with Red Hat. Somebody from Red Hat with us? No, nobody yet. This is a company who joined also the Eclipse IoT pretty early. And I have to admit, we learn also a lot from them how to work. If you want to see how a distributed company is really working, Red Hat is a very good example. And they also know that they also have the attitude that they want to share the way they're working with us. So they don't want to overprotect their key knowledge. They rather believe that if they share more of that, they get also a stronger partner network. So it's really about openness. But these are the projects we are repositioned ourselves as champion in the Eclipse world. And I have to admit that personally for myself, without the experience from 2004, I wouldn't have been able to go through all these processes myself. And when I was thinking back what my idea was about open source in 2004 and what's today, it's completely different. So it's also a learning curve for the people who are willing to change or make things happen. It's just taking into account too. Yeah, and this comes to the question, how do you convince people? Now we come a little bit to the flex side. So what do you think is in the package? Okay, your t-shirt. What do you think is not opening up? Just think about what it is in there.
Well, I think the three parts together are can-like things.
Okay.
Because this looks rather glamorous. People will advise to use for champagne. This is like a candle.
A candle, okay. Good. Yeah. So what I did to convince, when we try to jumpstart this open source in a bigger way, we needed some money. And in order to get some money and people on board, Hans Malte and I, we asked in 2006 for €1 million. And we failed completely. We did not even get a cent. And yeah, and then my analysis was we asked the wrong people because we stuck somehow in the middle management. And the question was, how do we ask top management? How do you get this open source topic to top management? And one morning, while showering, I said, it's very simple. You just have to ask for a lot of money. So we asked for €60 million. And we had no clue what for, to be honest. But we said, at least we would then talk to the right people. And this worked out with some interesting story. For example, the corporate research executive, Mr. Dietrich, who was also responsible for that we are here today in this building. I had an elevator pitch with him, really in the elevator. And he said, I saw your proposal about open source. And said, is this really something we should tap into? I said, yeah, there are a lot of engineers, are very capable, and if they do open source style, they do more. And by the way, there are a lot of companies in the US who have engineers who love to do the work they really love in the evening or on the weekends. And I said, AT&T is probably the biggest contributor to open source, Unix and Linux at that time, because there are so many frustrated engineers in the company. And then he looked at me and he said, yeah, but automotive embedded software has no community outside. And then I looked at him and said, do you believe we don't have any frustrated engineer within Bosch? And then he looked at me and said, oh, we rather invest now. So the point is that you cannot make sure anymore that the knowledge really stays in the company, because with internet, everybody can work in the evening and the weekends too. So I was then asked to give a presentation to the prestigious board of all the vice presidents for engineering within Bosch in the most prestigious room the Bosch Group has to offer. And that is a room in Schillerhöhe, that's our headquarter, that's called Audi 2. Who has been in Audi 2 already? Some of the Bosch guys have been there already. So this is a room that is set up English style, very old style, with old seating. And Robert Bosch's own books he bought from Humboldt and Co., they are all lined up on the side. Nice cupboard. So you really feel like it's an English club. And it's nothing to do with agility and change and very different setting. So, and these poor vice presidents, they were asked the whole day to sit there in the meeting and butcher at slides, like you show you later, about, yeah, I think, 6 hours. So what happens if you are sitting there for 6 hours? And you get always slides, and you're basically asked to get some money on topics you don't want to invest, but you have because your boss is there, and all this politics is playing, and yeah, basically they want to go out to their customers, do something different, but they are forced to be in this meeting. So if you look at them, and they're all men, of course, at that time we were all men, now we have also some ladies in there, they're basically bored, they want to escape, they want to do something differently. So my idea was, so how do I convince them to do something that's very counterintuitive for them? I did the same like I did with you. Before the meeting started, they all got a package. And I told them, you're not allowed to open this before I start presenting. So this package was with them a little bit longer, for 3 hours, waiting there, and they were thinking, what is in there? What is it all about? And when I started my presentation with my first slide, this was, by the way, this way, this slide, I asked them to open the package. And now all the energy that was in the room, like, finally I can do something myself. I can open the package, this energy burst. And it was also something in there they did not expect in there. Because I had an example of a distributed project. This is, by the way, strictly confidential, so please don't copy that one. This was a project we did for Ford, for a gasoline engine, where you see all the teams that were involved. And this was in 2006 and 7, so already very distributed. And this was the motivation that distributed teams is an issue within Bosch, from a real example. But how do you really tap this into the other side of the brain was the core question for my presentation. But you have to feed some core material in there. This was the explanation that from culture, distance, and time zones, sorry, this is all in German. At the time, we had to do these presentations in German to convince people. Now we can do this in English. We have to overcome. And that from, you see in the middle, this typical hierarchy problem, we have to change to a network. So also understood, but not very difficult. And this was the game changer. We did a comparison, how more efficient the Linux kernel development is compared to one of our core products in the Bosch Group. And Linux kernel was 11 times more efficient developed, and time to market was 4.5. That was a long report explaining this in detail. So this was for the objective side of the decision. So there was something you can say, oh, 11 times. If a computer gets 11 times better than we are, we have an issue. Of course, at that time, no of other competitors did. But of course, if it's possible to do, you have to tap into that. Yeah, and then I put up a chart how we are planning to get more engineers around the world. This was the official numbers they set up. You see that at that time we were around, it was 2006, it was 25,000 engineers, and we had a plan to grow beyond 32,000 engineers, and even some of them more abroad. So in Europe, we rather stuck on the same level and we hire more people in India, in US, and somewhere else in Asia. So let's just see, okay, the problem I have today with my international teams will get even bigger, and they had a lot of problems already. So, and instead of taking all these numbers and so in the foreground, I basically set up these packages. Now you can open the package and look in what is in there. Yeah, this package, there's nothing in there. So the idea was that I sent out flags. So everybody got a flag where his engineers had this vice president for engineering had an engineer. So there were some people who had flags from India, China, Japan, US, all the European countries. And suddenly they experienced that, my dear, there were some people who had 30 flags, some had 10, and our board member, he got, I think, 45 flags. And some of the flags, they had no idea what it was all about. it's a country, we have an engineer. Along with that, we had a small package. That's why I have this one with me. They also got this small element where you can post the flag in there. So you may put this in now. Now you get the rubber off and then get this distributed around. So everybody had a nice stand like this with all the flags in front of him. And now I'm asking you to distribute the flags, yes? And now think about it. If you hand through and look at the flag that is in front of you, you see one of these. What is your emotional feeling around? Do you have some memories from your job or your vacation? Something you were really... Yeah. I know how to do that already. Yeah? And maybe you just, if you just speak out now, what you feel if you see some of these flags, what your feeling is. Just that you... Yeah, no idea, okay. Venture, okay. What else?
Big,
oh. Diversity. Communication pain. Communication pain, oh. Which country was that, huh? Come on, you all know this, huh? If you're in India and you talk to a German engineer and he's not happy about your quality, what do you feel? You feel pain, you feel not understood.
Language
barriers. So if you really admit now what kind of feelings you have, this is what you're tapping into. And these decisions, which you cannot really justify with simple numbers, are basically decisions you take on with the other side of the brain. And you have to tap into that one. And in this room we now then had, like we had more than 200 flags. And that was the first time this engineer had to admit that, shit, we are an international company. We are not a Swabian company anymore. And we named the project Global Software Development. So we didn't name it open source. We named it Global Software Development and motivated rather from the flags and said, and the benchmark is open source. So that was the core idea. So this was a way how to sell this with the flags. And that's why this was the last topic of my presentation, capturing the flag. So what I have now is I've 30 more slides I can tap into if you have a specific question how to convince a certain stakeholder in your organization. I don't know whether I have a slide for each and every stakeholder, but it's something we can make in the question and answer session if you like to. And then if I'm out of time, I have one more slide to show.
So now we are all that standing between you and coffee, but still, if you have questions, just raise your hand. I'll bring the microphone.
How you your arguments to convince middle management?
Middle management, yeah. So this disruption argument was one. Let's go. This one that worked pretty well. Bruce Perens wrote a nice economic article where you should engage into what kind of license and business model with software. I don't know whether you know this article. There's a link down there. It's called The Emerging Economic Paradigm of Open Source, written in 2004. And he basically said, on the right-hand side, if you have just one customer for a very specific software, you do contracting of software. If you have mass product software, you're on the left-hand side, that's the Microsoft Windows, for example, where the cost of distributing the software is 90% of the real development cost. You see this with Microsoft operating system. They just spend a very small fraction on the development of the software itself. Most of the money goes to sales and marketing and stuff like that. And if you're in the middle of that, between mass market and individual software, then open source is the most viable economical step to that. And then they look at these numbers, they do project calculation, and then they try to find partners, either internally, some other departments, or they look at also for external companies to look into this. This worked pretty well for this Eclipse tooling, because we had the decision, do we do an AUTOSAR tooling for Bosch, or do we do something with other companies together, which was clearly not on the left-hand side, because automotive tooling is not a mass market, but it's also not good to put this in a one customer bucket. So this worked out well. Then another one that worked well is this one. You rather invest your own people only on elements where you can distinguish from the rest of the world. And all the other pieces, it's this crown jewel argument you take from an open source platform. So this is what I feel were the most best arguments. All the others are for other stakeholders.
How would you address the people who bring up security and intellectual property concerns?
Security, I don't have a slide, but it's very simple. The more transparent you are with the software, the less the risk of security you have. But these intellectual property guys, they're difficult to tap. And what I use very often is this slide. Sorry, this isn't German, but it's an original slide. There, in each and every culture, there is a word for the commons. There's also a history around commons. You know, Almende and structure. And this goes back to intellectual property law, which is from the 12th to the 15th century. And people who are well educated in intellectual property law, they know this. There's even a Chinese mechanism for that. So if you're in China, they also have a mechanism how they share water to grow the rice. And the water is part of the community. And there's a clear social pressure system around how this water is shared. And they even written laws around that one. And if you start from that direction, looking at how to work things together, because there's a common good, we have to take care of all ourselves, they understand much better. And you see, this is some right for water. Fish is still organized that way. If you look at international fish laws, it's still made that way. And in each and every country, you find a very interesting story that is very specific for that area. You find something for Stuttgart area, and you know, from Sweden, for example, if the islands around Stockholm are frozen, everybody's allowed to cross all the water and enter each island, and they are allowed to hunt on the islands. This goes back to the time when they were short on food in winter times. And if you tap into these cultural elements, you get the nerve of people, because they see, hey, this is something we had to survive on in the past, and this is a good pattern. And this is the way I cracked Mr. König, who's our intellectual property guy and our headquarter. Not easy to crack, I have to admit, it took me some years.
I think we have time for one, maybe two more questions, and then it's coffee time. And Stefan will be there in the break, so you have the chance to engage with him afterwards.
Thanks for sharing your experience. I was wondering, you talked at one point about having in the biosphere 10% of time protected for employees that their managers couldn't affect. I was wondering if you'd be more specific around how you protected that time, were there attacks made on that time, and how that interplay went between the BIOS program and that 10% time for engineers.
So I don't think we actually had like a corporate agreement that everybody can spend 10%, or like, you know, there was not something that everyone would do. But we were allowed to get everyone inside our BIOS projects, and then we could buy them out with a certain amount of money that we had for 10, 20, sometimes even 50%. But there was no provision that I'm aware of, except the contracting, which is the important part, because it makes it formal, makes it official, makes it easy for managers to sign off on. I think that was the most important part, actually. Not so much the money that we spent, but the formality of the whole thing that made it, I guess, compatible with how the company worked. And that's what got people into the biosphere and got managers to sign off on. And then we had those developers who just did it. They said, you know, boss, you can allow me to do it, or you can say no, and then I'll find another business unit. And some did, actually. There's one example in the room, actually. I'm not sharing. Wink, wink.
Keeps in the room anyway. But I think the middle management part is a difficult part, not the employees. So people who want, willing to and go an extra mile to fight for that, usually you have them, and then more are joining. But for a middle manager, there's not short-term payoff, no? Because you lose some capacity on your project. In many cases, these are the best engineers they have anyhow. These are mostly the case people who are mostly motivated to do even more. Get the thing along. Actually, we have some Bosch middle management also in the room. Somebody willing to share his good and bad experience with that one? Nobody wanted
a coffee break.
Come on.
How many people you had in there? How many? So we started actually together with Georg and some people to develop tools which helped us for debugging and even testing and production purposes. And this started out of this initiative, and there was a lot of internal motivation to jump on that. And initially, it was kind of it was kind of a gray area. It just developed, and in the meantime, we made ourselves intentionally dependent on that because the result was so good. So we have now set up, stronger contributions. We have still this exchange, and it has been rolled out to production in the meantime. Initially, it was all kind of under the umbrella somehow, but it was in the gray area. And now it became a very official part of our delivery. And I think that was important that this didn't happen overnight, but that grew over time. So it has grown over years. How many years? I don't even know anymore.
Nine
years. So it was a slow start, but it was a lot of motivation. And nowadays, we are fully dependent on that. And we are happy to be, by the way, dependent on that, because it works, and it still develops. So I think that's a good approach, and that's why within Toyomo Technology, we are convinced that this can be just a good example in one area, which should be used and copied in other areas.
Thank you very much.
I think it's also one element, the Thermo Technology app Georg developed also helped. Yeah? So there was a very early product coming out of the biosphere and it hit the fair and the market, which was also emotionally attached and for everybody in the Bosch group that this was the first app for a Bosch device in the App Store. And I don't know, how important was that in the end? It was a proof point at least, no? That you can do it. Something that a business unit probably wouldn't be so quickly at. So some final words, very quickly. This is more about what you should take with you. You can Open has many elements now today. So it's a Swiss Army knife, and it's not only open source. It's a lot of elements in that. And you really have to look into what kind of problem, business problem you have and which part of the openness helps you. Also admitting that the most successful companies, like Apple, they are only open in very few elements. They make very distinct decisions where they do that. And this is something I think we went through, and we still have some issues that openness is more important than getting the secret in. Yeah, and the other thing I learned in the end is our teachers were not so wrong. Actually, just repeating this 11 times doesn't hurt. Keeping this in mind again. And it's just the way of communication and human brains work, practicing it over and over. I've been very successful with this slide, also my organization, to continue that, because the organization also try to fail back again, and you have to motivate them to going back again. So if you just remember this one, it's also fine. Yeah, and my final words is stay in touch. Join us in this approach, either in or open source. It's a good way to do business and also learn and exchange experience with great people. I have to admit, I am very happy that I went on this path, because I learned much, much more than just staying in the company. And with that, I encourage you to take a coffee and start the networking. Thank you.